All right, we're going to call the March 1st Land Use Committee to order. And our only business tonight is ordinance Z664-20. And committee. Let's see, we want to start with, I think I'll start with Matt from the township. You can go right there. What we're looking for tonight, the idea here is, and anybody tell me if I'm wrong, and Mr. Hollibaugh's here, Dan McFeely from the Historical Society, Matt Schneider from Township, and we also have the architect for the building that we're talking about here. Technically, we don't have to go through the rezone for you to build the building. The more of the concept here is kind of a house cleaning, so that when you would deed this back to the Historical Society, it would be a legal use. If it were residential, it would come back as a non-conforming use or whatever. I'll let you say that term later. So this is more housekeeping than something that has to be done before the building would be built. Whether we do this or not, the building can be built there. Okay, I just wanted to clarify that. Could you give us an idea so that the neighbors know what the this, and I will point out this is a concept. This is not a approved final. The approved final would be, since we would be putting some bond money into this, would be a agreement between the CRC and the township to get it to a final point.
So, as part of the Clay Township Impact Program,
will you say who? You have to say who you are, please.
Oh, just for
is your microphone on?
Hi, I'm Matt Snyder, Clay Township Board.
Thank you.
As part of the Clay Township Impact Program, which was an initiative created about 3 years ago, we look to identify as many needs in the community that were not already being covered by the city. One of those happened to be the Historical Society that has been something that Clay Township has financially and otherwise supported for since its inception. And the depot there has been a landmark of our community for ever. Unfortunately, their house that they've been working out of needs to be condemned and has no working or living life left into it. We took this opportunity to see what we could do for them. It is a very small parcel, as you can see in this picture. We engaged Studio M Architects to put up some concepts. There were some concepts floating around a couple years ago that were just imaginative of what if, but would never have fit on this property. This concept is in the programming stage right now. What I mean by that is we're going through and meeting with the Historical Society, identifying what their spatial needs are, not only today, but 75 years from now. And then our other mission at the township is community space. We feel that Carmel and Clay Township has done a great job building community spaces over the years, but due to growth, they get overtaken. So it's been an initiative of ours to make sure there is space for community to gather, whether it's for meetings or the Quilting Society. Whatever it is, we're looking for space that the community can still rally around. This building, in programming-wise, we're probably about 90% there, identifying the needs of the Historical Society. As you can see, it sits about, here's the property line. There's a storm sewer there, so it sits about.
So Matt, can you point with your mouse by any chance, because this is also being broadcast? Or is it? Is it not tracked?
It's on. Yeah, it's
okay,
on.
Sorry.
Oh, there you go. You can use your finger here.
All right. So if you can see where the little mouse is now, that's the existing depot. There was an the depot has been moved once before. It used to sit on the Monon as a functioning train depot. It's been moved off the depot to save it, and at that time, an addition was put onto the depot to add a toilet and a furnace. There's nothing historical about that add-on. We're going to take that add-on off and put the depot back the way it originally was, Carmel's original train depot. What we're showing, when I'm coming back over here, this is the south property line. There's about, tell me if I'm wrong, about 10 feet. 10 feet between the southern property owner's fence and the start of the building. There is a storm sewer there that creates that divide. And then we've tried to stay as far as we can off of the western property owner, just so we're not right on top of them. The front of the building is going to be right up against the Monon with some hardscape and very approachable by the public. Dan, I don't know how to switch the slides. Let's do that. I don't think they're interested in the floor plan. So here's the floor plan of the potential building looking from the northeast. As you can see, the original depot's there. We tried very hard to make sure that this new building didn't completely dwarf the existing depot. And the existing deck on the depot, this was actually an idea of a former city councilman from 40 years ago. Thought that instead of having a deck, it would be neater to kind of recreate the train platform that was there. So Dan's done and his group have done a lot of research going back to the heyday of when the depot was its most active and tried to create this the train platform that it would have sort of looked like back then. This building is three active stories, and then you can sort of see peeking out at the top. There's a little bit of a faux wall for the elevator to land on the rooftop garden and to provide privacy and a barrier for the residents to the west, so that if there's an event going on the rooftop, the noise travels east to where the established urban environment is and is not traveling to the west. These windows are all UV filtered for exhibits and protection of any artifacts that'll be in there. But this is the concept we're rolling with right now, Indiana limestone to fit with the rest of Midtown's look. Probably a little more window than what's in Midtown, but we feel that to make it a more inviting place, that's what we wanted. Their gift shop will be on the north end. They run a very small gift shop out of the depot right now. But mostly it'll be gallery space welcoming place for the community. I want to see the rendering from the back so we can see what the. So this is what in that road is not a road. It's actually the property owner to the west's driveway. But what we didn't want to do was create a flat wall for the residents to stare at. So we've tried to make this as architecturally pleasing to the eye as possible. Again, this is in the programming stage. This has not gone through the township's formal approval of look or the city's, and we still have to meet with the property owners around here to make sure that they like what they see. And I've gotten some notes today that we'll put in there, specifically, is there really a need for windows on the backside, which probably there is not. But that's the use of the land would be as a public gathering space and keeping alive the 150-year tradition of the township and the city.
Committee, any questions for Matt? Or any? Councilor Hannon.
So I'll have more questions, but just what's the height of this building?
I don't know. Okay. I mean, it's a concept.
Do you plan that maybe the architect can comment on?
Come on up.
What you intend for the height? Because there are restrictions either in C2 or in residential. And then what's the offset to the property line to the west there as it's envisioned? So, and I know this is conceptual, but at least get us in the ballpark.
So the offset to the west is the property's not square.
Will you say who you are, please?
Hi, I'm Dan Moriarty from Studio M Architecture. Is my mic on? Is red?
Go. If it's red, it is.
Okay. Thanks for having me tonight. The question was, what's our relationship to the west property line? And then also, what the height of the building is. To the west property line, the site's not exactly square with the Monon. So what we tried to do is line up essentially the front of the building with the new, if you want to call it, train platform on the front. And then to get to the back, it varies between like 7.8 and 9.5 feet from the south property line, or from the south end of the building to the north end of the building. It actually is a little more at the south end than it is at the north end. The height of the building itself is 3 stories, as Matt said. We haven't worked out structurally exactly what the floor-to-floor height is, but I think it's drawn at 13.4 right now. So 13.4 times 3 is 39, plus 4 is 40 feet to the roof deck. And then there's a story of stairs and elevator. The 2 stairs go to the top. And one thing we tried to do, so I can get it to change here. To keep the stairs and elevator and keep the height down, or the apparent height down, we've enclosed the stairs with glass at the top. Can we see that at all? It's very hard to see. But if you can kind of pick out at the top here, this is the elevator right there. And then this is just a service room to keep symmetrical. And then there's 2 stair towers. There's one here, and there's one here. And those have a small metal roof on them with glass sides. So, again, trying to keep that fourth level function as inconspicuous as possible, I guess, from the surroundings. And then, as Matt said, this in the back of the building, what we were just talking. Whoa, now what? There's the old rendering from back in the day. I'm sorry, it doesn't show up on my screen, so I'm trying to hit that little icon down there. There it is. Did I get it? There we go. So as Matt said on the back, we were just talking to the neighbors about there's really no need for any windows back there. The 3 small ones you see are in the stair tower landings on each side. We can delete those easily enough. The back one, I thought at the time it might be nice to be able to look through the building, but again, that's right in the elevator lobby. That's not a big deal. So we can delete that window and add more. If we like the green look or if we like the limestone look, we can certainly do that. So those are not essential. Here you can see the stairs a little better and the roof at the top. The elevators on the left and the service room on the right with the two glass stairs.
So just my follow-up is, and I understand this is conceptual, but and I guess we'll have probably Mike Hollibaugh speak to this. What you're describing is neither compliant with either R2 or C2. So R2, it says maximum height is 35 feet. And it doesn't describe the back offset, but I'm sure Mike can tell us what that is. I'm sure it's more than 7 or 8 feet because of a lot coverage. And in C2 also says 35 feet adjacent to R2. And my understanding out of the UDO is that the rear offset or the buffer offset between a residence has to equal the height. So that would be 35 feet. So again,
that's not right.
Okay, so we'll need to hear from, or at least I'll need to hear from DOCS on that.
Councilor Rowe.
Hey, Councilman Ryder, you pointed out earlier that township property is exempt from zoning on township property. You may point out that variances are also exempt.
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If I were to just take the first floor footprint, how many, I should probably direct this to you, how many square feet? I'm trying to get a feel for how big the building is.
The total building is only 15,000 square feet, including the basement.
Okay, wow.
So it essentially stacks, so a little over 30, maybe 3,200 square feet per floor.
Yeah, okay, very good, so. Thank you.
Councilor Austin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have questions about uses. You said there was be a meeting or gathering space. Can you talk to me about what some of these uses would be, and would it be an event space or more of a meeting space? Would there be rental charges?
It could be open to a number of different things. Ultimately, the township's goal would be for the smaller groups, like what we would do at the township offices currently, what we're going to do at the Carmel Clay Building, in the two public rooms there. Anybody from the community can rent it out. There is a nominal fee. We have no idea what that's going to be, but it, I mean, we're talking you're not getting a full-blown catering event, right? It's, if you want to bring in some warm food, you can. There's a little prep kitchen, but if you want to have your quinceanera up there, you're welcome to. The fee would be, at what we're doing at all the township buildings, is any money generated from that does not go to the organization inhabiting it or the township. It goes straight into a building fund to accrue over the 20-year life service of the debt until the township turns it over so that then they have operating capital to maintain the building after the government assistance goes away.
And so the township would manage those uses of the building?
It would go in an escrow account, yeah.
Township, but you would approve a request to use it?
Yes.
Okay. And then would there be hours for event usage?
They would conform to the City of Carmel's, whatever the City of Carmel's rules are on events.
Any other questions for Mr. Schneider before I move on? Okay, Mike from DLCS, Mr. Hallbaugh. One of the things that were questioned was if this were ever done a different project and it was C2, and the CRC had control of it, and the Historical Society was no longer part of this, which we'll talk to Dan about. What would the process be if somebody wanted to build something? The comment was, would there be any public hearing? Can you give us that process, please?
So at any point in time on a C2 project, it follows kind of a linear path that includes TAC review, just like any other project. There's the Architecture Review Committee, which is the CRC and departments, various departments in the city. A public hearing is required where public notice is made, just like any other project, whether it's at Plan Commission or BZA. And that public hearing occurs at City Hall, and it's documented, there's minutes, and the public's allowed to speak, just like any other.
I do. The thing I struggle with, it's a beautiful building, I like it, but what I'm struggling with is, potentially having issues that we have with another venue. If we're bringing an event center, not an event center, but, and I think it's needed, we need more public buildings where we can have events, but I really struggle with bringing events next door to residents who are used to having the depot and relative quiet. So what exactly are the city's, and you don't have to give me details now, but what would those restrictions or requirements be if there were events? Like, would they have to stop at midnight or, and I know, Mike, I'm kind of catching you off guard. I can get this answer later, but that's what I struggle with. I think it's a great building. I really like it, but struggle with it being so close to homes.
We don't really have restrictions. We have a noise ordinance that was recently amended that, that is going to box in really any business because of the inability to use amplified music after a certain hour, and just the 50 decibels is a very restrictive noise level. So, I mean, beyond that, absent, you know, site-specific commitments, I mean, there really isn't, we don't regulate hours of operation or use in that sense.
Okay.
Any other questions? Councilor Hannon?
So again, I'm trying to reckon with this because we got in our packet specifically the zone district comparison, R2, max height 35 feet, front setback 35 feet, 35% coverage. C2, 35 feet height adjacent to R2, 80% lot coverage. And then I hear Mr. Snyder say, because it's Clay Township, they can build however they want to. So again, I'm trying to figure out what's going on here from a zoning standpoint. You know, my concern, whatever the use is that the neighbor's input is involved in this, not just in terms of the construction, but in terms of the operation as well. We have that commitment to existing neighbors in the Midtown area. So again, explain to me, because again, I'm struggling here, R2 versus C2 versus the township being able to do whatever they want here.
Those are probably two really separate issues. I mean, when all this began, I really wasn't aware that that the township was going to own the building, which is kind of a game changer as far as how the city's regulations affect them. But I mean, that really this was an effort. I mean, the city has planned the Monon for many years. There's really two pieces of real estate that are not zoned today that sort of fit in with if we're trying to offer predictability to neighbors and sort of fulfill the long-range plan for the Monon, which is mixed use in the urban section. I mean, it goes back in 2008, we did a study called the Monon Esplanade. Shortly after that, we did the Monon overlay. I mean, we have policies in the comp plan. All these things support the rezoning and the development of that frontage along the Monon with mixed-use buildings from Main Street essentially to Carmel Drive. We didn't rezone the urban section of the Monon because of the redevelopment and the C2 that had already occurred, which was going to be superseding it. And here we are today just trying to clean things up a little bit, and yeah, but we have a specific proposal. I mean, generally the C2 rezones aren't about a building, it's about land use and achieving, you know, the development goals. I mean, here we have a building. And so this is maybe some of the specific questions should be for them, but I can answer as best I can your questions.
So again, that's my question. Technically, is that correct that if this was C2, for it to be compliant with C2, 35 feet would be the maximum height?
Yes.
And what is the requirement for offset for next to residences for C2? What is that requirement?
So the building setback is zero, but the landscape buffer is, as you had mentioned,
35
feet. I mean,
there's a
height, yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead, Councilor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So just we get another chance to at this when we're going to vote to approve either the funding with the TIF bond that would be associated with this, or later when a building is worked out, it'll come back to council. So I'm not on the land use, right? It won't go back. So really the only other time for us to negotiate would be with the funding aspect, right? Okay. So I was just raising the question whether we could approve the zoning and then work out some other details while the funding is being worked out.
That's not really a question for you, Mike.
Yeah. Sure.
Any comment on that, Matt? Or Mr. Schneider?
So what you've mentioned really only affects whether the building is limestone or whether it's brick. That's That's the only thing that the bond you mentioned too would have any impact on this building. Limestone is what conforms and fits the area. But we still will be having, we haven't even started our outreach yet. And this, we're in the programming stage of what needs to be done. I mean, I just reached out to the Historical Society last week and asked for some neighbors' contact information. So there will be involvement. It'll be the look of the building will be approved by the township with input from the city and approval from the CRC. But the township won't approve anything until we feel we've satisfied the concerns of the adjacent property owners. And we've done that on all 21 projects we're actively working on.
Councilor Hannon.
So would now be a good time to get some input from the neighbors?
Not yet. I'm going to get everybody in, and okay. I want them to get all the information, and okay. then I'm going to ask them their opinion.
Okay.
So what you're saying is if you were to do this in brick and use no money from the bond, then the CRC wouldn't be involved at all.
That is accurate.
Okay, that would be an accurate statement. Okay,
but we welcome.
You welcome the input. I understand.
We want the building to be to fit into Midtown
Correct.
As best as it can.
Correct. Mr. McFeely, please. What we're looking for from you, the comments were, if the Historical Society were to sell the property and get rid of it and we rezone it to C2, what would happen? So can you give us, as a spokesman for that group, can you give us your plans?
Sure. Dan McFeely, president of the Historical Society, going back 4 or 5 years now. This project has been on our wish list for 10 plus years. There has never been any indication from any of our board members to ever get rid of this land. And we have had offers. People have called us, hey, you want to sell? You want to sell? No, we don't. We feel fortunate to be where we are. We feel the only reason we're getting such wonderful gifts from the township and the city, I hope, is because of where we are. It is a premier location. And I don't want to downplay the community aspect of this building. We're planning a visitor center on the inside. People come in there, they're not just coming in to get a little taste of local history. I mean, after all, people come here from all over the world. They don't always care about local history. But there's public restrooms, there is a kiosk with brochures to hand out, there's volunteers helping people know where to go. Satisfies that. It also takes care of our archive needs, which are very pressing. Gives us some office space. Councillor Campbell, when we talk about events, we're not talking about parties and concerts. We're talking about the Carmel Arts Council needs a space to have a meeting, and we happen to have a meeting room. Yeah, you can use this for free, okay? That is our goal as a board. Now, there are such things as the rooftop garden. And the reason that we have been trying so hard to get that is because moving forward, we feel like the Historical Society will need a little source of income. So a small wedding party, a reception, something like that. No loud music or anything of that nature. So it's a very, I've been talking to Jane. Jane was probably one of the very first people in the city of Carmel to see what we had in mind because I had a picture on my phone. And when I was volunteering, when her house was open for the Christmas walk, I showed it to her because I knew she was curious. And from day one, I've told her, you know, we will not have anything looking over into your yard. I don't know. Did I get it? Okay. The rooftop would not look out to the west. I mean, you've all been to various rooftops around the city. There's always one or two sides you just can't see. That's our plan there. We want people to be able to see the Monon, to experience the beauty of the Monon, not to invade her privacy. And so we have been talking to her for a long time. I personally haven't spoken to any of the other neighbors. Jane's always been the one because she's right next door and she keeps the closest tabs on us. Just so you know, the little Monon Depot, we are hoping to turn that into a permanent Monon train museum. So it all plays together. We're trying to find ways, you know, our mission is to educate, communicate history, and to be a good member of the community. So I can tell you that our board has no desire to ever sell this. So we deed the land over to the township so they can do what they need to do, and then at some point it comes back, and it will perpetually be the Carmel Clay Historical Society. It's our home. We have no desire to ever get rid of it.
Mr. Schneider, do you want to comment on anything on that real quick?
Well, I'll get to you. Speak to the legal agreement, because we're not there yet. We haven't even gotten to the legal agreement with the Historical Society, but I can say, for instance, with the Carmel Dads Club, they can never sell their land. So the way the agreement's set up is it is our land, it's the township's land, until the debt is expired, and then it goes back to the township or to the Dads Club. Should the Dads Club fail to exist, then that property would be transferred over to the school system, because we felt that they would be the best recipients of that land.
You're basically giving a history of this type of deal.
Yes. And at no point in this instance, in the language with the Dads Club, which would be the same as the Historical Society, could they ever sell this land for profit. So the concerns about selling the land, they would not be able to do. It would be, after it left the township, it would be the Historical Society's in perpetuity. If the Historical Society should ever dissolve, it would revert to the township. But frankly, if it dissolves, it would go to the city.
Right. Mr. Worrell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is anyone able to give me an idea as to how many people might be on the rooftop for one of these events?
Right now, the maximum without any landscape buffering, without thickening the rails, the most allowed by the fire marshal, without having to add a staircase, which we would keep it under that so that there would be no staircase on the back side of the building, the most would be 149.
Okay, thank you.
But that's everybody standing, not at tables, to get to that number, there would be nothing else going on up there but people just standing in one spot.
Kelly, this is your chance. Any questions or comments? Unmute.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
Yeah, I was just taking some notes, and I guess I'm a little concerned about the 40 feet as of the roof deck. That's going to be a really, really big structure. And I absolutely love the style of the building and everything, but I am just a little bit concerned about how large all in all this would be, and for the back of that building to only be about 7 feet to the west, that's almost like having a decent sized promenade on the back of the building. And that is concerning to me. And the music on top, that could be a big problem too. So I guess I do have a few concerns about how this will affect the privacy issues and the concentration of people in general with parking and just all the things that the community bears when you have an influx of people.
You can comment on that if you want to.
Well, Dan can give a more technical response, but I would say that as far as parking, there's a garage less than a quarter of a block to the south where we would anticipate people parking with handicap right in front of it that's already there. The rendering has not, again, concept, has not taken in the blocking of the view off of the rooftop. Like, you will not be able to see west. So the rendering kind of has some glass and some architecturally pleasing things, but you will not be able to see west over the building. So there won't be any. We just did this at the Carmel Clay Building on Veterans Way, and we did some, because it's right up against, I mean, you're looking into somebody's apartment, and we did a bunch of sound tests and decibel tests, and found that that blocked as much, if not more, than standard ambient noise from the road below. I don't know if that satisfies the concerns, but Dan can speak a little more technically.
going to show a plan of the rooftop here.
We lost Kelly Baskett, by the way.
We lose her.
But go ahead and answer what you were going to answer.
This is Dan Moriarty again from Studio M. This is a plan at the rooftop level. As you can see, it's just the upper part of the stairs, the elevator. But the idea was to use that block, as Matt said, to form that, if you want to call it, barrier to the west, to close that off as much as possible, as you saw in the rendering. And architecturally, I guess, just my thought on the height and the program that the Historical Society has, there's a certain, I think, critical mass, right, of what they do, that if you don't solve the program or if you don't provide the spaces that they need to function, hopefully, as said, for the next, you know, decade, that you obviously lose the effect of the building. You end up still having them divided or having them making do with other types of storage, et cetera. So this is about as an efficient of a program in terms of the archives, the children's programs, just the displays in general, the cafe, the gift shop, and then the roof as you see it here, that can fit on that site within the parameters that are there. We are taking off, as Matt said, that, if you want to call it, 70s edition that had the mechanical unit in it. So we can really make that existing depot a treat like an exhibit, like it really should be, that it's not just a you know, the depot that happens to sit there and needs a little bit of upgrade, right, with the deck and whatnot, but it's to make it a more, you know, exhibit quality type space. Also with the design, I think it's important in a city. I mean, our goal is not to blend in with other buildings at Midtown, right, and the Mona. I mean, this is a historical society, and I think a good city is a fabric that's got monuments that are connected, right, either by walking, like the Palladium, like this type of building is a monument that sits within a fabric, not part of the fabric. So making it brick or making it less obtrusive, to me, it would be a missed opportunity from the standpoint of creating another. This is really an amenity for the Monon, right? And all the money you put into the Monon park along there, this becomes an extension of that, and hopefully it supports that well.
Real quick, Jane, before we run out of time, I want to know if you want to add anything. You can pop up to the microphone, please. And you can take your mask off while you're speaking.
Jane Fleck. Do I need to give my address? Or?
No, don't give your address.
Okay.
Citizen of Carmel.
How about that? thank you so much for taking a slowed down, closer look at this. I really appreciate that tremendously. Probably the two things that are the biggest concern are noise, because right now our patio is rendered useless until hopefully we can get from the building behind us, the goat, we can get that building built, and hopefully then we'll be able to be in our backyard. But right now it is too loud. So I'm a little concerned about hearing 145 people, because we have up to 300 behind us, and that's close to 500 people, which even without music, it is unbelievable how loud that is. But I appreciate the wall, although and from what I understood, you said that wall would be solid. So.
Yeah, that's after hearing your concerns, I mean, that's something we'll adjust the design.
Okay, because with holes in it, you know,
absolutely.
I mean, that isn't. And the other thing, so the noise is one thing, and then the privacy is the other, and we've talked about that. It's not that I'm opposed to windows on that side, just so people can't see our property through them. So to let light in, that's fine with me. You know, windows that give you light but no visible. And then the building, I'm okay with it being connected. You had mentioned, you know, we might want a little walkthrough there. The walkthroughs tend to be a problem because people come from other places and, you know, they go on to our property. So it's okay with me to have solid. If we want to be the Monon, we'll go around. So so the noise probably is the biggest thing. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Committee or council? Mr. Hannon.
So, again, my concern here, and you know, I think it's great looking building. I love the idea of having the Historical Society be there and be more active. I'd rather see that than another mixed use. So don't misunderstand me. My job here is to advocate for the neighbors, particularly the neighbors that are closest in. And my suggestion here, Mr. Chairman, is that I'd like some more conversations, particularly between Ms. Fleck and the architects and the Historical Society, to make sure that she's at least moving towards comfortable before we would act upon this. Because I think in addition to some of the design features, the height features, covenants and restrictions that could be asked for within this, or I would like to see covenants and restrictions that would also be specifically stated in any sort of rezone proposal, would also be additional assurances and protections. So again, my suggestion would be reconvene after more conversations with the neighbors. Because okay, we have 2 weeks, is that correct?
I'm going to make a point. May 15th would be our next meeting. The drop-dead date on this is the 17th. So we do have until our next meeting, other than tonight's meeting. But I'm going to point something out. The township is going to reach out and work with the neighbors. What we vote on this has zero effect on that. I'm just pointing that out. I have no problem waiting until the next meeting. But what we vote on here has literally no effect on that.
And I do understand that, Mr. Chair. But
we have no leverage here.
I understand.
Pointing that. I just want to make that clear. We literally have no leverage with this vote. With the bond money, we have leverage with the facade of the building. But in reality, it's up to the township and the Historical Society to work with the neighbors. We will literally have no say in it. I just wanted to make sure that was clear.
That being said, I want to facilitate that conversation. I would feel more comfortable supporting this if we got more feedback from the neighbors.
And I want to make sure the neighbors know that literally what we're doing has zero effect on what's going to happen.
Again,
so I just want to clarify that. Okay, I got it. We're moving on.
Okay.
So I was looking for clarification. Just because we may put in a list of demands, what effect does that have? So the township, the Historical Society, they've come to us, they've shown us the plans. They didn't have to, correct?
Correct.
But they did that as a courtesy.
We did this, okay, as you recall, with the Dad's Club building, and I stood up here and I made promises that I would take care of certain things at the Dad's Club, and
you did.
Have I taken care of every thing I said I would do? I have.
I think so, yes.
And that included satisfying an entire neighborhood, fixing problems that were not ours to fix.
Anybody who wasn't involved in that, that was a lot. They went a long way to do that.
Delayed the project 6 months, so that it gave me pause. And I told Chairman Ryder I had pause coming here because the last time I did this, I made promises that I kept, but it ended up adding almost $500,000 to the project costs and delayed the project 6 months. And the township is not willing to do that again. We will work with the neighbors. We will get this project built beautifully and on budget. And we won't, as a township, approve a design until we feel that the neighbors are satisfied. And when they're satisfied and the Redevelopment Commission is satisfied, we'll break ground. That's our plan moving forward.
Committee, because we're going to end this in about 2 minutes.
I just don't know what further we can do in another meeting.
There is nothing else we can do.
Because I would make a motion to send this back to the full council.
With
a favorable recommendation. I don't want to spend another hour discussing it if it really has no bearing on what the township can or can't do. I appreciate, again, that was presented to us. I've heard the explanations, but I don't see why we need to discuss this for another hour.
As council members, we can stay involved in the process and be their advocate with the township. At committee, there's really nothing else we can do. Do you wish to second it?
Again, the only thing I would ask for Ms. Fleck is if is there any benefit for us to delay this any further from your standpoint?
We will continue to be your advocate, we promise, but the township is good to work with. I was involved in the whole process with the Dad's Club. They went above and beyond to make it happen.
Second.
Was that a second?
That's a second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are adjourned.
First, by making certain that a long-term fiscal plan that works so that we can guarantee to people living here and people starting businesses in Carmel, Indiana, that our tax rates will stay stable or go down.